Good morning, Arlene, and this is Dan, and we are so excited to be here and to worship our King, for he is worthy. Amen. So wherever you are, please join us as we worship our Lord. Amen.
The highest King would welcome me. I was lost, but he brought me in, know his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the Son at last he has ransomed me, his grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free. Child of God, yes I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am. I am chosen, not forsaken.
As a father,
I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. Yes, with every breath
everybody. Praise God. That was awesome. Arlene, Dan, thank you for that worship service. It was great. Again, I apologize if you were having technical difficulty. It wasn't our fault. There was nothing we could do at our end. We've been having some cable problems ever since that storm, that big windstorm that came the other day. But praise God, we're going to persevere. We're going to keep going on. We're going to keep moving on. We're going to bring forth the word to you no matter what. Amen. I'm glad you're here watching, and I'm glad you're here listening. We're going to greet each other. But we're going to do something a little bit different. We want to greet one another with some other members of our family that we don't normally get to see. So enjoy our greeting this time, okay? Go ahead.
You've got a friend in me. You've got a friend in me. When the road looks rough ahead and you're miles and miles from your nice warm bed, you just remember what your old past said. Boy, you got a friend in me. Yeah, you got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. You got trouble, and I got them too. There isn't anything I wouldn't do for you. We stick together, see it through, 'cause you've got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. Some other folks might be a little bit smarter than I am, getting stronger too, maybe, but none of them will ever love you the way I do. It's me and you, boy, and as the years go by, our friendship will never die. You're gonna see it's our destiny. You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me.
Amen. Those were some beautiful pictures that we had where we enjoy our favorite pets. As you saw, I no doubt had the coolest pet that was out there. Amen. As we get into our service, I first want to ask us all to keep in our hearts and in our prayers the Merritt family. Our brother Ray, his brother, went home to be with the Lord. It was not COVID-related, but keep him in prayer, and his wife, I believe her name is Suzette. Ironically, I had her in youth group many, many, many years ago underneath me, so please hold them in your prayers. As you all know, we've been having a little bit of a fundraiser going for our heroes, our nurses, our EMTs, those that are on the front lines. And we started by saying that the church itself would pay for, I don't know, 10, 15 people who would win prizes. And we asked you to nominate. And we've got 40 nominations, I believe. 40 nominations. Praise God. That's exciting. And we asked you guys to give to see how many more of those that we could bless by winning a prize, a gift certificate. And I'm proud to announce that all 40 of our nominees have won. Amen. That's exciting. So we're going to spend this next week reaching out to everybody and letting them know that they won and asking them what they want to receive. So I'm excited, praise God, that we can give back to the community, that we can touch the community in even the simplest of ways to let them know that we love them, we care for them, we're praying for them. And let's never forget that's why we're here as a church. A church is here to impact its community. If a church is not impacting its community, then why is it there? So let's not forget that we are not here to form our own little commune. We are here to touch our community, and praise God, here at Abundant Life, we're doing everything within our power to impact our community, and I want to thank everybody who donated, everybody that gave, to bring in that extra money so we could bless all 40 nominees, and praise God, it's well-deserved for what they're going through. The title of our new series that we're starting today is A View from Heaven. And how many of us know that things look a little different from a heavenly perspective? And that as Christians, as believers, we're supposed to have that same perspective in life. We're supposed to have a heavenly perspective. In Isaiah chapter 59, verses 8 and 9, I'm going to go back one more verse. It says this, God says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts are higher than your thoughts." God says that his perspective, his ways, his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. And so therefore, he sees things in a whole different way. He sees things from a whole different perspective. And as sons of God, we need to learn how to look at life through that higher lens, that higher perspective. And things change. You know, I've told a story here in the church in the past that I can remember a couple times over the years, I've been playing golf with our brother Rich Cornetto. Wake up, Rich. Our brother Rich Cornetto. And, you know, he's obviously much taller than me. And there were several times where I'm in the fairway and we stop at a ball and I'm looking for my ball up ahead and I can't find it. And I said, you know, where's my ball? And Rich goes, "Oh, it's right there." I said, "But I can't see it." And I stepped up on the golf cart, and guess what? I was able to see my ball ahead of me. And no doubt 100 yards ahead of Rich's ball, too. But that's a whole other story right over there. Well, why wasn't I able to see it? Because from my lower perspective, there was just a little hill, a little rise in the fairway that was blocking my ball. Well, in this life, sometimes there are things that are blocking what God has promised us. And when you go to a higher level, when you look from a higher perspective, a different perspective, you see things that are there that you didn't see before. It changes the way that you see things. So that's why God wants us to look at life through a different lens, a higher lens, or a higher perspective. For my ways are not your ways. My ways are higher than your ways. And so the title of the series is A View from Heaven. And the title of today's message in that series is, Who Are the Winners in Life's Lottery? This is an odd message, I think, that the Lord laid in my heart, but I know it's for somebody because I just can't get it out of me. So I have to preach it out of me. You know, when you're a preacher and something gets stuck in you, sometimes the only way to get it out of you is to preach it out of you. So I'm going to preach this out of me because I believe that God put it in me because I believe there's somebody that needs to hear this message today. Who are the fortunate ones in life? Who are the winners of life's lottery? You can look at that through the normal perspective of the world, or there's a higher perspective to look through, and that's what I want to talk about today. You know, I remember years ago reading a story, I think it was in one of those Chicken Soup for the Soul books or a similar book that was out there, and I never forgot, it made an impact on me. And it was written by a man, the story was written by a man. He was telling that when he grew up, he had a brother that was a few years younger than him, and his brother was born, and he was mentally disabled, his brother. And he said, now, growing up in life with a younger brother who was mentally disabled, man, it was a real drag for him, and it got on his nerves, and oftentimes he would get mad at his brother. And he said that, you know, when he'd go out to play with some of his friends, he'd be running out the door, and his mother would yell his name, and he knew right away what that meant, and he cringed. And his mother would say, don't leave without taking your brother with you. And he knew right away, there goes all my fun. And he would get mad at his younger brother sometimes. And, you know, it's difficult, you know, growing up with somebody who has a handicap of any kind in a family. And as he was going through life, in his mind, he would sometimes make fun of his brother, you know, because he said, oh, man, he has so much joy in emptying the dishwasher. He used that as an example. And he said as he got a little bit older in life, he looked back and he said, you know, thinking about it, my brother never hated anybody in his whole life. My brother was never insecure about another person. My brother never had unforgiveness in his heart towards anybody. He said, my brother is the happiest person I know. He said he smiles at everybody. He laughs at everybody. My brother loves everybody, and everybody loves my brother. He said, my brother finds joy in the most mundane of tasks. He's happy to do anything and help anybody. And at the end of his little story, he said, I'm no longer so sure who the fortunate one was and who the unfortunate one was in my family. Was I the fortunate one, or is my brother the fortunate one? And that impacted me because, boy, when we look at a situation from a different perspective, we kind of see different things. You know, in the world, they would call that, it's having a paradigm shift. It's seeing the exact same thing from a different perspective. You know, turn with me to Matthew chapter 5. And if you're familiar with your Bible, you know that we're going to Jesus and his Sermon on the Mount. Matthew chapter 5. And it starts with the Beatitudes. Now, most people don't realize it. What Jesus was preaching, and what I'm about to read to you, we take so for granted right now. We've heard it, oh, yeah, it's nice, so we think it's cute. And sweet and stuff like that. No, you've got to understand, when Jesus preached this, he was preaching radical theology. It was a major change. This was like considered crazy stuff to the people at that time. Jesus was preaching an entirely new way of looking at life. Looking at life from another perspective, looking at life from a higher perspective. He was preaching a paradigm shift. You see, the Sermon on the Mount was where Jesus was introducing the rules and the foundations for the kingdom of God that he was establishing on earth. And so he was saying things that would be in stark contrast to the kingdoms of this earth. And again, we've heard him so many times that we just take him for granted, but you have to understand, this was a radical departure for what people understood and people believed in that time and in that day. And we all know, blessed is he, blessed is he, blessed is he. Well, what Jesus is saying is, these are the people who are going to be blessed. He's saying these are the fortunate ones in God's kingdom. In contrast to who are the fortunate ones in the world that we live in today. So notice what he says. It says, and I'm going to start in verse 2, chapter 5 of Matthew. It says, he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. That, again, is a stunning, radical perspective that Jesus is giving. You have to understand who he's preaching to. He is preaching to the elites who were there. He was preaching to the religious leaders who were there, who thought that, well, man, we own the kingdom of God. We are the rulers. We are the leaders in the kingdom of God. We are the high ones. We are the exalted ones. When we go into heaven, that man, they're going to have a parade for us, and Jesus or our Messiah, whoever he is, they didn't believe it was Jesus, is going to shake our hand. That's what they thought, and that's what the people thought. The people thought that it was the elite in society, it was the wealthy, it was the powerful in society, that they will inherit everything, that they're the ones who are going to get everything, because that's what the world pounded down on society for untold millennia. And here comes Jesus out of nowhere, and he completely flips that upside down. This is a complete, total change in life. He says to those that are poor in spirit, those that are broken on the inside, those that are have been in poverty their whole lives, those that have had nothing their whole lives, those that have been kicked, stepped on, beaten, ignored, looked over, those that, check this out, those that had no hope and no future. These people had no future. There was no lottery that they could win. There was no chance that they or their children would ever go to a college or a university. There was no chance they would ever come into wealth or power. If you were born in a poor system, you were going to stay in that poor system. Your children, it was only the rarity that ever came out of this. So out of the blue, Jesus looks at them and says, yours is the kingdom of heaven. That is, again, a radical, crazy change that is made. And I'm sure everybody was standing there listening, going, I've never heard this before. You mean there's something waiting for me at the end of my rainbow? I mean, there's something great waiting for me? And I'm sure that the elite that were there were like, whoa, what's this, man? I don't like this. Everybody should bow down to us and follow us. I mean, they literally had people, you know, kissing their feet of the leaders, whether it be religious or secular leaders, and kissing their rings. And now all of a sudden, Jesus says something radical. It's a major change. He says, no. The kingdom of heaven is going to those who are poor in spirit. In my kingdom, everything is seen differently. In my kingdom, the fortunate ones are the unfortunate ones in the kingdom of this earth. Then he says, blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. And again, he's following the same line and the same pattern, the same theme all the way through. Blessed are they that mourn. He's not really talking about somebody that's mourning the death of someone, even though, of course, I believe that will apply. But he's talking about those that are mourning how society has treated them. Those that are mourning, that they're the ones that get nothing. They get, again, kicked out, as I said before. They have nothing going for them. They're getting beat up all the time. They're mourning their lot in life. They're mourning their situation. They're mourning their position in life. Blessed are those. He's saying, don't worry. If that's you, you're going to be blessed in my kingdom. He said, for you shall be comforted. So you see what he's talking about. Blessed are those that mourn. You'll be comforted. You are living in a life of discomfort, he's saying right now. Life has been unfair to you. Yes, I agree that life has been unfair to a lot of people. I 100% agree with that. But guess what? It's not over until the promises of God and God's kingdom comes to pass. As I've said a couple weeks ago, every wrong will be made right in the eyes of God. There is no injustice in God. God is the ultimate, Jesus Christ was the ultimate social justice warrior. Except that he will bring justice and social justice in his kingdom for eternity. And that's what our hope is. That's what our great joy is. So he says another radical thing. You're mourning, you're complaining about your lot in life. You've been without and lacking your whole life. Don't worry, you'll be comforted. There's an inheritance or there's something coming for you. Then he goes on, blessed are the meek, for you shall inherit the earth. Again, this is another radical departure from the orthodoxy of the day. Because in the day, they thought that the meek were the weak. That's how they thought. And the meek didn't inherit anything for centuries. The meek got stepped on, kicked, run over, and taken advantage of. Yet in the kingdom of God, Jesus said the complete opposite. Oh, no. The meek shall inherit everything. Not those that are so strong and so mighty and so pompous and so powerful in their own mind and their own thinking. It's the meek. They're the ones who are really going to inherit everything. Now think about this for a second. Who owned everything at this time when he was preaching this? Who owned it all? The powerful, the mighty, the wealthy, they owned it all. So what was Jesus saying? Jesus was saying all the wealth and all the power that the mighty hold, guess what? For eternity, it will be taken away from them and it'll be given to those who were meek, those that were kind-hearted, those that were loving, those that were caring. They are going to be the ones who will get it for eternity. See, that's why I said the Sermon on the Mount was a radical departure of the orthodoxy of that day. The Sermon on the Mount literally flipped everything upside down, and it changed everybody's way of thinking, or at least it should change everybody's way of thinking. Blessed are they who do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Again, another radical statement that he made. The word filled there being satisfied or fulfilled. Well, he's drawing a comparison over there that in the world, we are encouraged to hunger and thirst for what? For successes, for power, for wealth, for a name, for popularity, for fame. We should hunger and thirst and pursue those things. Yet what did Jesus say? Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. What is righteousness? Righteousness is being in right standing with God. Righteousness is doing what is right in the eyes of God. He said, you will be fulfilled. All those people who ran after the treasures of this world and stepping over whoever they could on the way and kicking aside anybody they could on the way to get there, he said, they're not going to be fulfilled. But those who pursue after righteousness, they are the ones to be filled. So as we're reading this, who is Jesus saying is the fortunate ones on this earth? Jesus is saying the meek are the fortunate ones. The broken are the fortunate ones. The humble are the fortunate ones. Those with nothing, those that mourn, those who have been kicked and stuff. He's saying those are the fortunate ones on earth. Not the ones who we think by our natural eyes, they're not the fortunate ones. It's the ones without are the fortunate ones in the eyes of God. Verse 7, are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Praise God. Be merciful to people. Be loving, be caring. Give people that benefit of the doubt. Give them the second chance because you'll receive mercy of God. Now, what's the clear implication in that? As I often say, the law of opposites. If you were unmerciful towards other people, God will be unmerciful towards you. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Amen. God, it's not about the outside, it's about the inside in the eyes of God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Amen. We're not warriors. We're not battling, fighting each other. I'm not talking about fighting against an enemy that's coming in to destroy. That's you know, on a whole different plane over here. We're not talking about that. Then verse 10 and verse 11, he says, blessed are they which are persecuted because of their righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And he continues and says, blessed are you when men shall revile you, hate you, and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil falsely against you. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward. Praise God. Again, we see that in the kingdom of God, everything is flipped over. People are going to be persecuted for their faith. They're going to be mocked because of their faith. They're going to be cast down because of the faith. They're going to be kicked out because they're trying to live a righteous life. They're going to be abandoned by their own family, abandoned by their own friends. And God said, rejoice. Why would I rejoice over something like that? Rejoice because great is the reward that is awaiting you. You are one of the fortunate ones. So praise God. Who are the winners of life's lottery? Who are really the fortunate ones in this life? They're not the ones who we think they are by looking through our natural eyes, by thinking through our natural mind and our natural thought process. Because in Matthew 5, Jesus flips everything around and changes it all. Now, let's just spend a few minutes and look at things from a more practical perspective in the world we live in today. When we're born, when we're growing up, who do we look at today and think they're the more fortunate ones? They're the luckier ones. They're the ones that have won life's lottery. Well, let's start with the most obvious. Those that were born into wealth or riches. How often have people said over the years, they're the lucky ones. They're so fortunate. Man, they get whatever they want. They get away with whatever they want. And we, many people have, you know, raised their fists towards them. They've grinded their teeth towards them. And we've lamented ourselves. Oh, you know, I wasn't born into a rich family. I was born into a poor family. Well, what does the Bible have to say? What does God have to say about who the fortunate ones in life are? Well, I'm going to turn to Mark chapter 10. And see what God has to say on the subject. I'm going to go back to verse 23. And Jesus looked around about and said unto his disciples, how hardly shall they that have riches enter into the kingdom of God? Whoa. And the disciples were astonished at his words, but Jesus answered again, said, children, how hard is it for them that trust in riches to enter into the kingdom of God? Check this out. For it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. Wow. Who are the fortunate ones in life? That when you read the Bible, you know what you find out? You find out those that were born to wealth, those that were born to riches, they're the unfortunate ones. Let me ask you a question. Based upon Scripture, do you think there are more wealthy people that are in heaven? Or do you think there are more poor people in heaven? It's obvious. The answer, it couldn't be any clearer. The Bible tells us that wealth works against us. Because we tend to put our trust in wealth. The nature of our flesh grabs onto wealth, and we put our trust in our wealth instead of putting our trust in God. Jesus went as far as to say, it's easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than it is for a rich man to go to heaven. So if you were born in a lower class family or a poor family, guess what? You're the fortunate one when it comes to eternity. When it comes to where the true riches and the true wealth will be. In James, turn to James, it's way back towards the back of your Bible. James chapter 5, just want to read the beginning of one verse. It says, go to now, you rich men, verse 1, and weep and howl for your miseries that shall come upon you. Your riches will become corrupted. Wow. You rich men, go ahead and weep and howl for your miseries that shall come upon you. That doesn't sound too good. That sounds horrible. But how are we raised in this fleshly, earthly society? We're raised to envy those that have money. We're raised to be jealous of them. We're raised to think, oh, how lucky they are. Are they really lucky? I don't know about you. I don't want my odds of going to heaven to determine or to be determined by whether or not a camel could pass through the eye of a needle. I don't want my odds to be equal with that or the same with that. So the reality from a higher perspective, the reality from a higher plane is that those that are born into the wealthiest of families, they actually have a disadvantage and to make it into the kingdom of God. Because the love of money is the root of all evil. And Jesus said, again, woe unto them to make it into heaven because they put their trust in their riches. So do you see how everything is completely reversed? That what we've been raised to think? If you're here watching this, stop your complaining. Stop your whining if you don't have certain things. In fact, rejoice because your reward is the kingdom of heaven, the Bible says. And you know what? Feel sad for those that have all this wealth and all these riches. Because you know what? There's a good chance, according to Jesus, that they're not going to make it to heaven. You're the winner, the one with the poor heart, the poor soul, and the poor bank account. You're the fortunate one in life, according to the scriptures. Let's look at another thing that we all look at. The person who was born with power and success, okay? Man, how lucky they are, we say. They get whatever they want. They have power, they have success. Well, back off from that a little bit, and let's think about this from a higher perspective, from a higher plane. People with the most power and the most success often fall. When I say often, I mean at a high rate, fall into the sin of pride. Thinking who they are. Thinking that they're better than other people. That they're more deserving, that they're more privileged than other people. Come on, that's been happening forever. So is that an advantage or a disadvantage? I'm going to turn to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1. And find out what it says. Luke chapter 1, verse 51 says this. For he hath showed strength with his arm, this is God, and he hath scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has scattered them about. He hath brought destruction to the proud, the Bible says. Remember what Jesus said, blessed are the meek, blessed are the poor in spirit, which means basically blessed are the humble, blessed are the broken. Well, the Bible teaches the exact same thing. Now, I'm not saying that every person that is born with wealth or every person that is born with power and success, that they're going to fall into the sin of pride. I'm not saying that, but I am saying that the vast majority of them are and do and have forever. Proverbs 15, verse 25, it says that God will destroy the house of the proud. God doesn't like the proud. God doesn't like pride. The Bible says that pride goes before a haughty spirit and goes before destruction. So you tell me, who's the fortunate one? James 4, 6 says, God resists the proud, but gives grace unto the humble. He resists the proud. He literally puts his hands against them and resists them and pushes them back. We know Jesus taught, whoever exalts himself, I will cast down. But he who humbles himself, what? I will lift up. Remember, Jesus reversed the whole economy in his kingdom. The whole way of looking at life in his kingdom, he reversed it. And let's be honest, it's very hard to be humble when you have all kinds of power, everything at your fingertips, anything you've ever wanted your whole life. It's hard to be humble. So again, you tell me, who are the fortunate ones in life? The ones who were born with all great success and all great power handed to them? Or the ones that were born in a more humble situation? Where was Jesus born? He was born in a manger. Thank you, brother. He was born in the most humble environment you could possibly find. He wasn't even allowed to go into the inn because the inn was crowded. He had to go back with the animals. And he was born in a manger, in some kind of trough where the animals ate out of. And they probably just put some hay in there and put him in there. His beginnings were humble. And then he grew up in Nazareth, a very humbling town. In fact, it was so humble that when people said he was the Messiah, they found that he came from Nazareth. They said, Nazareth? What good thing could ever come out of Nazareth? It was the littlest, the tiniest amongst all the cities. Yet Jesus came out of Nazareth. Praise God. Amen. So again, the unfortunate ones are the ones who were born with all this power and all this success. Let me ask you this question. Do you think there are more people in heaven who had great power in society, or more people in heaven who had less power and were poor and were meeker? Well, according to Jesus, those people who had the most power got the hardest time getting into heaven. So again, I say, if you were born into a situation where, man, I didn't get this, I don't have that, rejoice, because you're the fortunate one in the eyes of God. Let's go over another one. Let's go over our looks, how we're born. Man, it's so unfair. She doesn't have to diet. She was born a size 2. She was born with perfect cheekbones and long flowing hair. It's so unfair. It's so unfair that he was born 6'2", 6'4", and big shoulders and could jump, and he was born athletic. Michael Jordan worked hard, but I promise you, he didn't work hard to be athletic. He was born that way. He could jump through the roof. He just honed his skills, but he was born with those skills. How unfair! How many young men today watch sports and they say, how unfair? And unfortunately, we live in a society where, what do? Where we worship those that have cheekbones that are formed in a certain way. On those who their eyes are a certain color or they're big. Or those men who are a little bit taller, a little bit stronger, and have a little bit of the square jaw. In fact, you have people who are paying billions of dollars a year to go to plastic surgeons just to have their jawline changed, their cheekbones changed, their weight changed, their hips changed. You have people having ribs taken out so they can have a smaller waist. I mean, it's crazy what's going on out there. People are obsessed with looks. And again, I understand. But I want to be like them, and they're so lucky. Are they really lucky? Are they really fortunate to be born, quote, beautiful? Are they really that fortunate? I'm not so sure. Not so sure because, you know, vanity is one of the famous 7 deadly sins. And vanity is not a good thing. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 3, the Apostle Paul says, I put no confidence in my flesh. None whatsoever. No confidence at all. Yet what do you think that the, quote, the beautiful people of the world do? They put all their confidence in their flesh, all their confidence in their looks, and they spend money galore on trying to highlight every little thing about them, any little flaw in them they go crazy over. Vanity, vanity, all is vanity, Solomon said famously. Put no confidence in your flesh, but it's almost impossible for a, quote, in our eyes, beautiful person, not to put confidence in their flesh. Proverbs 31:30 says this. It says, charm is deceitful and beauty is vain. What does that mean? It means our looks are a deceit. It means our looks are not really good for us. They're bad for us. Good looks don't draw us closer to God. They tend to lead us further away from God. That's what that means. It means don't put your hope in the outside. Put your hope in on that which is on the inside. That's what that means. It's a deceit. Kind of like Jesus said, the deceitfulness of riches. What's the deceitfulness of riches? The deceitfulness is, if I have riches, I'm going to be happy. That's a deceit. That's a lie. You're deceived by that. And the same way with looks, we're deceived into thinking that, oh, if I put my hope in my flesh, if I put my hope in my looks, oh, look how much better I am. Are you really? I don't think so. Vanity, vanity. It's hard to be humble when you've got people telling you your whole life how beautiful you are. Hard to be humble. Take my word for it, I know. It's tough. In 1 Samuel, many of us know the story. Samuel the prophet came, and I'm 1 Samuel 16. Samuel the prophet came, and he came to the house of Jesse, and he was going to anoint the king. And there were all these sons that were there. And Jesse had the horn of oil. He looked at all the sons. He saw the eldest son. He said, surely this must be the Lord's anointed. Why? Well, he was taller than everybody else, stronger than everybody else, more handsome than everybody else. And Samuel said, this must be the Lord's anointed. It's got to be. Look at him. He's got his cheekbones and jaw are perfect. His hair flows beautifully. He was Fabio before Fabio was ever born. This guy, look, he's got rippling muscles. It must be him. And God spoke to him and said, no, you're wrong. It's not him. Because then God went on to say, I don't judge like other men judge. I don't look on the outside of men and find value in that. I find true value and true beauty on the inside. It's not him. And then he went through every son that was in the house, and everyone, God said, nope, 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 nope. He turned to the dog, he turned to the cat, he turned to the gerbil. There was nobody else there. And Samuel said, are there none other sons? Because there's nobody here. And they all said, well, we have one more, but surely he's not worthy. He's not deserving. He's the runt of the family. He's out there with his few sheep. He's David. He's a boy. He said, go get him. And as soon as he walks in, comes into the house, the Spirit of God speaks to Samuel and says, that's the one. Immediately. The whole family didn't even regard David high enough to bring him into the house to invite him in when the prophet of God showed up. You got to understand, this is a big deal. The prophet of God did not show up at everybody's house. If he showed up at the house, this was a huge thing. Everybody in town would know, because that's how big. The prophet of God showing up was like God showing up in your house. And they didn't even think it appropriate to have the youngest son called in. That's how little they thought that he had to offer. They thought, surely he can't be the one. Yet in the eyes of God, he was the exact one. In the eyes of God, it's what's on the inside that God finds the most beautiful thing. And how unfortunate it is that we don't look at life in that way. Turn with me to Isaiah chapter 53 for a second. Now, I already told you that Jesus was not born into a wealthy family. Jesus was not born into a wealthy situation. He was born into a poor family. Now I'm going to tell you something else that may shock you. Jesus was not the best looking guy in his class. How do you know what Jesus looked like? The Bible says that Jesus was not the best looking guy in the class. Now, I know we watch movies of Jesus on TV, and it's always played by a handsome actor. We got long flowing hair or the most beautiful eyes in the world. That's not reality. Let me tell you what Jesus, the only description we have of Jesus and his physical appearance, other than when he was hanging upon the cross. Isaiah 53, verse 2. Speaking of Jesus, the Messiah, for he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, as a root out of dry ground. He has no looks nor handsomeness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we shall desire him. Did you realize that was in the Bible? The Bible makes it clear that when you look at him, you're just going to look right past him because there is nothing about his physical appearance on the outside that you shall desire him. That you want to be, man, that guy is good looking, man. I want to follow him because of his looks. Not at all. He was a plain, ordinary, at best, looking guy. And yet he saved the whole world. And yet he was the beauty of heaven. Because he looked at, God looked at the inner beauty where it really counted. Praise God. So I don't know about you. I want to be considered in the same category as Jesus. I want God to look at me and say, son, you're beautiful, and have nothing to do with what's on the outside. I want him to look at the condition of my heart and say, son, you're so beautiful. I'm so proud of you. Not because of the outside, but because of who you are on the inside. Let me ask you a question. Do you think that heaven is filled with more beautiful people? Or do you think that heaven is filled with more average, ordinary looking people? To me, there's no brainer. To me, there's no doubt about it. Because the average, ordinary person rarely gets caught up in the sin of vanity, in the sin of thinking how beautiful they are, in the sin of thinking that they're actually even better than other people because of their, quote, beauty in the eyes of man. God finds true beauty in his creation. You know, I've shared this every once in a while. It's an interesting point that I'm going to apply to here. How God values his creation far and above anything beautiful that man can make. There was an interesting law in the Old Testament that said when you build an altar, all you could do is stack stones together, maybe throw some dirt on it. That's it. In other words, God didn't want you to take some stones and quarry them and then polish them and make them look like beautiful, shiny granite and make them look like the most beautiful stones in the world and the most beautiful shape in the world. God said, I want you to take stones, raw stones. I want you to take my creation, and I don't want you to add anything to my creation because you can't possibly improve my creation. It's impossible. And I want you to build an altar, and I want you to put your sacrifice upon the things that I created, the things that I find most beautiful. My rocks, my stones. Well, it doesn't look so good, man. They're just boring stones. Come on, I can improve it, God. I can make it look better. I can polish it. I can cut it. I can shape it. Now, the minute man puts his hands to something that God has made, man has tainted it. Man has ruined it. And that kind of applies to what we're talking about when it comes to falling into the trust in, quote, beauty in the eyes of the world. God made you, and he made you to be beautiful in just the way you are. You don't have to add another thing to it. Don't you dare think that you have to find a magazine where a person is spray painted all in that magazine and say, that's what I need to look like. Don't you dare give into that lie. You are beautiful the way that God made you. You're that beautiful rock that he placed in the ground, and he wants to use you for who you are. Don't fall prey to the lie of beauty. Don't look at those people out there and say, oh, they're the lucky ones. No, they're not. Because chances are, they're vain, they're proud, and they put their trust and their confidence in the flesh. And they don't put their trust and their confidence in their God. Last verse. Way towards the back of your Bible, 1 John. 2. First John 2, I'm going to start with verse 15. God says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. Now, why would God say that? God is saying that because he's saying these things of the world that we love, when I say we, I mean mankind in its fleshly nature, they will take you away from God. They will pull you down the wrong path. So he says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. For if any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Next verse. First I want. For he says, for all that is in the world, all worldliness consists, he said, of three things. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and pride of life. The lust of the flesh, my riches, my money. I could buy anything I want. I can get anything I want. The lust of the eyes, beauty. What I behold, I look, it's beautiful. And the pride of life. Power, success, who I am. It says, for these things are not of the Father. These things are of the world. Verse 17, we'll go on one more verse. And the world will pass away. And all these lusts or all these things that we desire, they will pass away too. But he that does the will of God will abide and will live forever. Praise God. God said that those three categories that I just preached on, that we foolishly think make you the winner of life's lottery. God said all those things are going to die. All those things are going to pass away. All those things are meaningless. And if you're caught up in those things, the love of God is not in you. So who are the fortunate ones in life? Who are the winners of life's lottery? Are they the most beautiful in our eyes? Are they the most powerful in our eyes? Is it the one born with all this wealth and all this money? Are they the fortunate ones in life? From the view from heaven? No, they're not. They're actually the unfortunate ones in life. Seek the beauty that God has given you at your birth. That's on the inside of you. Seek after righteousness, Jesus said in the Beatitudes, and you will be fulfilled. I'm going to pray right now for people that are watching this, and you've been tormented because you believe the lies that the world has told you. You believe that you're not beautiful, and you're angry. You believe that you were not born the right way, how unlucky you were. I'm here to tell you from the Lord, you are the winner of life's lottery. You just wait to see what's coming for you because you have been faithful in God and you are beautiful beyond words in the eyes of your God. And I want to pray for those that you have not. Throw that out of your mind because you have a lot. Go from the have not to I have a lot, because I have a lot in Christ. I have an inheritance for me that's waiting for me. No more pity parties. You're here and you're having a pity party. You're watching me right now. You've had pity parties, man, over and over again because nothing ever works out for you. And it doesn't matter that you made all the mistakes and you got yourself in those horrible positions to begin with. Stop having the pity party. You have the greatest treasure in the world that's awaiting you in Christ Jesus. Rejoice! because in Christ, you are the fortunate one in life. You're the winner of life's lottery because you've accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior. I want to pray for you right now. Father, in Jesus' name, I come before you. And Lord God, I pray for that person who's watching right now, that Lord God, as I said some of these things, I know that their heart was pricked on the inside of them. There's even a couple of people that they're hearing this, they got tears in their eyes. Yeah, I know what God is showing me. And I'm speaking to you. Lord God, I break the lie that this world and the God of this world, the devil, has bound over them. The lie that they're not beautiful. The lie that they're unlucky. The lie that nothing ever works for them. How poor they are. Those are lies. And the Father of lies have sown them in. I break those lies by the power of this message that was preached in the name of Jesus Christ. And I pray that that you would be set free. That you would know. That you would rejoice in who you are and how fortunate you are that God made you just the way you are. Praise God. Amen. God loves you. In Christ, you've won the lottery of life. Stop looking at things the way you used to look at them. Start looking at them from the higher way, the higher plane. For God said, my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. My ways are higher than your ways. The kingdom of heaven and the inheritance of this earth belongs to you, according to Jesus in Matthew chapter 5. Amen. God bless you. Have a great, great day. Rejoice in your salvation. Rejoice that you have a prize that's awaiting you. And I'll see you next Sunday, and hopefully next even Wednesday. You'll tune in. We're going to be sending out some emails for some things for Mother's Day coming for you, so we can put together a nice video for that. I love you. I miss you terribly, church. I miss you terribly. And again, I apologize that we had some technical difficulties early. Was not our fault. There's nothing we could do. But I can't wait to see you. I want to hug you. Take this hug from me right now. I love you. God bless you. Have a great day. Enjoy the weather. Amen. Bye-bye.